Heavenly Father, on this night when we recall the sacrificial love of your Son and the power of forgiveness, move our hearts to be open to your love, to receive your forgiveness, and to share that divine gift with others. We ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen. Our opening hymn this evening is 782, Only This I Want.
The power of Christ's blood. If we wish to understand the power of Christ's blood, we should go back to the ancient account of its prefiguration in Egypt. Sacrifice a lamb without blemish, commanded Moses, and sprinkle its blood on your doors. If we were to ask him what he meant and how the blood of an irrational beast could possibly save men endowed with reason, his answer would be that the saving power lies not in the blood itself, but in the fact that it is a sign of the Lord's blood. In those days, when the destroying angel saw the blood on the doors, he did not dare enter. So how much less will the devil approach now when he sees not that figurative blood on the doors, but the true blood on the lips of believers, the doors of the temple of Christ. If you desire further proof of the power of this blood, remember where it came from, how it ran down from the cross, flowing from the Master's side. The gospel records that when Christ was dead, but still hung on the cross, a soldier came and pierced his side with a lance, and immediately there poured out water and blood. Now the water was a symbol of baptism and the blood of the Holy Eucharist. The soldier pierced the Lord's side. He breached the wall of the sacred temple, and I have found the treasure and made it my own. So also with the lamb. The Jews sacrificed the victim, and I have been saved by it. There flowed from his side water and blood. Beloved, do not pass over this mystery without thought. It has yet another hidden meaning, which I will explain to you. I said that water and blood symbolized baptism and the Holy Eucharist. From these two sacraments, the church is born. From baptism, the cleansing water that gives rebirth and renewal through the Holy Spirit, and from the Holy Eucharist. Since the symbols of baptism and the Eucharist flowed from his side, it was from his side that Christ fashioned the church, as he had fashioned Eve from the side of Adam. Moses gives a hint of this when he tells the story of the first man and makes him exclaim, "Bones from my bones and flesh from my flesh." As God then took a rib from Adam's side to fashion a woman, so Christ has given us blood and water from his side to fashion the church. God took the rib from Adam when he was in a deep sleep, and in the same way, Christ has given us the blood and the water after his own death. Do you understand then how Christ has united his bride to himself and what food he gives us all to eat? By one and the same food, we are brought into being and nourished. As a woman nourishes her child with her own blood and milk, so does Christ unceasingly nourish with his own blood those to whom he himself has given life. From the Catechesis by St. John Chrysostom, Bishop.
Thank you.
transgressions, truly I know them. My sin is always before me. Against you, you alone have I sinned. What is evil in your sight I have done. Be merciful,
amen. Collection is the universal collection for the shrines in the Holy Land run by the Franciscans.
Thank you. my God, why have you abandoned me? Why so far from my call of hope, from my cries of anguish? My God, I call by day, but you do not answer. By night, but I have no relief. Yet you are enthroned as the Holy One. You are the glory of Israel. In you, our fathers trusted. They trusted and you rescued them. To you they cried out and they escaped. In you they trusted and were not disappointed. But I am a worm, not a man, scorned by men, despised by the people. All who seek me mock me. They curl their lips and jeer. They shake their heads at me. He relied on the Lord. Let him deliver him. If he loves him, let him rescue him. For you drew me forth from the womb, made me safe at my mother's breasts. Upon you I thrust from the womb. Since my mother bore me, you are my God. Do not stay far away from me, for trouble is near, and there is no one to help. Many bulls surround me. Fierce bulls of Bashan encircle me. They open their mouths against me, lions that rend and roar. Like water, my life drains away from me. All my bones are disjointed. My heart has become like wax. It melts away within me, as dry as a potsherd in my throat. My tongue cleaves to the palate. You lay me in the dust of death. Dogs surround me. A pack of evildoers closes in on me. They have pierced my hands and my feet. I can't count my bones. They stare at me and gloat. They divide my garments among them. And for my clothing, they cast lots. But you, Lord, do not stay far off. My strength, come quickly to help me. Deliver my soul from the sword, my life from the grip of the dog. Save me from the lion's mouth, my poor life from the horns of wild bulls. Then I will proclaim your name to my brethren. In the assembly I will praise you. You who fear the Lord, give praise. All descendants of Jacob, give honor. Show reverence, all descendants of Israel. For he has not spurned or disdained the misery of this poor wretch. Did not turn away from me, but heard me when I cried out. I will offer praise in the great assembly. My vows I will fulfill before those who fear him. The poor will eat their fill. Those who seek the Lord will offer praise. Many hearts enjoy life forever. All the ends of the earth will remember and turn to the Lord. All the families of nations will bow low before him. For kingship belongs to the Lord. the ruler over nations. All who sleep in the earth will bow low before God. All who have gone down into the dust will kneel in homage. And I will live for the Lord. My descendants will serve you. The generation to come will be told of the Lord, that they may proclaim to a people yet unborn the deliverance you have brought.
The Lord be with you.
With
a reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. May the Lord open our minds, understand his words, or listen, may proclaim it in our hearts that we might live it. On Palm Sunday, we read from the Gospel of Mark, the Passion of the Lord. Earlier today, we read from the Gospel of John, Passion of the Lord. This evening, we read our Lord's prediction of the meaning of his death to his disciples. If the world hates you, be aware that it has hated me before you. If you belong to the world would love you as its own, because you do not belong to the world, but I have chosen you out of the world. Therefore, the world hates you. Remember the word that I said to you, servants are not greater than their masters. If they persecuted me, they will persecute you. If they kept my word, they will keep your words. I will not leave you orphans. I will send the Holy Spirit of truth, who comes from the Father. He will testify on my behalf and lead you into all truth. And Jesus said to them, in a little while you will no longer see me, and again, a little while and you will see me. Amen, amen, I say to you, you will weep and mourn while the world rejoices. You will grieve, but your grief will become joy. When a woman is in labor, she is in anguish because her hour has arrived. But when she has given birth to a child, she no longer remembers the pain because of her joy that a child has been born into the world. So you also are now in anguish. But I will see you again, and your hearts will rejoice, and no one will take away your joy. On that day, you will not question me about anything. Amen, amen, I say to you, whatever you ask the Father in my name, he will give you. His disciples said, now you are talking plainly and not in figurative language. Now we realize that you know everything, and we do not need anyone to question you. Because of this, we believe that you came from God. Jesus said to them, do you believe? Behold, the hour is coming and has arrived when each of you will be scattered to his own home, and you will leave me alone. But I am not alone because the Father is with me. I have told you this so that you may have peace in me. In the world, you will have trouble, but take courage. I have conquered the world. The Gospel of the Lord. Well, thank you for coming this evening and remembering this most holy of days. As we reflect upon the meaning of the Lord's suffering and death, I believe there are two most misunderstood realities of life: love and forgiveness. Sacrificial love and forgiveness. And the two collide in Jesus' crucifixion. So just think for a moment. Have you ever experienced self-sacrificial love? I know I have. Think of the one or ones who you have experienced that kind of love. Perhaps it is a mother, a father, a brother or sister, a dear friend. We're mindful of those people whose name we don't even know, who gave their lives for our protection, for our nation. Self-sacrificial love is divine love. And the only way we can live it is by the grace of God. It is a non-selfish love, but a self-giving love. And we see in God, think for a moment, power of God, the power of Christ, the power he had at his disposal. Now, I've worked with law enforcement for over 30 years. And in my younger days, I focused on the power of protection that comes from knowing how to defend oneself. Whether it is through training of self-defense, many, many hours of going through that with the Game Commission and with the Bureau, physical self-defense, and then self-defense with weapons of all kinds, guns, of course, knives, other interesting items to protect oneself. And when I was younger, I thought, if I had these skills and this power, I wouldn't have to fear, ever. No matter where I was, no matter who I encountered. And I did that for many years, working with these wonderful professionals who do that sort of thing for a living and are always thinking about the attack and how to defend from it. But here we have Almighty God, who could turn in an instant into dust the very ones abusing him. And he chooses not to do it. I have to say, in more recent years, my greatest weapon against evil is my guardian angel. And the more I became aware
of the Spirit. The spiritual reality of the world in which we live. We live too much just looking in the material world. We ignore the spiritual world and the power therein of God to protect us, alert us, and give us wisdom and guidance. Almighty God could have crushed them all, but he didn't. Why? Because he knew that you and me would suffer. And he wanted us to know that there is no suffering in this life that is beyond his love. Nothing can be done to you and me by the evil one that is beyond his power to save. No illness, no attack, no butchery, nothing. Nothing. And as he is being murdered, he says, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." And as difficult as it is for you and me to love in a self-sacrificial way, how much more difficult is it for us to forgive? That is a divine act. But it is an act that God takes very seriously. He even teaches us to pray to forgive as we desire to be forgiven. Many years ago, actually in the 15th century, George Herbert, who was a poet, a bit of a theologian and a priest, he said, "He that cannot forgive others breaks the bridge over which he himself must pass if he would ever reach heaven. For everyone has the need to be forgiven." Now, we all saw the other day the terrible accident of the bridge in Baltimore, just falling like a house of cards because of this ship, cargo ship. It touched one of its supports. And I'm sure you saw. It just completely disappeared. And it made me think of these words of George. Now think of this for a moment. Try to call to mind the person or persons that you can't stand. It might be a parent. It might be a sibling. It might be a boss. It might be your pastor. It could be Father Ben. Or maybe even Father Aaron. But it wouldn't be Sister Annie. But no, seriously, I know there are people that come on the television, or I even hear on the radio, I have to turn it off. Do you think Jesus died for them? Do you think he died for Putin? Do you think he died for Hitler? He died for everyone. But do we accept his forgiveness? Do you remember the scene in Schindler's List? When Schindler was at the commandant's house. And he was there eating with him, and the young servant girl, which was a Jewish girl, spilled some coffee or water or whatever it was on him. And the commandant screamed at her and everything. He was going to strike her. And Schindler said, "No, no, no, don't touch her." And he said to him, he looked him in the eye and he said, "There is more power in forgiveness . And then the next scene, you see the commandant in front of the mirror, and he's saying, "I forgive you. I forgive you. I forgive you." He's practicing. And he comes out of his room, and he's in his office, and one of his prisoners comes in, and they do the same thing. They spill something on his desk, and he goes on his papers, and he screams at him, and then he stops, and he says, "No, no, no, go ahead. I forgive you. Get out of here." And the person runs. And the next thing, this one's running across the prison yard. And you hear the crack of a rifle. And they fall dead. And it came from the commandant's window. It is only in Jesus Christ that we can forgive. So who haven't you and I forgiven? I hope tonight we all of us have nightmares. When we try to fall asleep and we see that bridge collapsing. And it's a powerful reminder of our own bridge to heaven that only exists on the stones of those you and I have forgiven. And the ones we refuse to forgive, the grudges we refuse to let go of, no matter who they are or what they are that cargo ship plummeting that bridge into the sea. It takes divine love to forgive. And we are all capable of it by his grace. And that's why he died for us. I slipped his fingers, I escaped his feet. I ran and hid for him I feared to meet. One day I passed him fettered to a tree. He turned his head and looked and beckoned me. By speed nor by strength could he prevail. Each hand and foot was pinioned by a nail. He could not run nor clasp at me if he tried. But with his eyes he bade me reach his side. For pity's sake, thought I, I'll set you free. Nay, take up this cross, said he, and follow me. My yoke is easy, my burden light, not hard nor grievous if you wear it tight. And so I followed him who could not move, an uncaught captive in the hands of love.
Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani.